After Jesus turned the money changers' tables upside down, the blind and the lame came to him in the temple and he healed them. That act summed up everything Jesus had been doing throughout his ministry. But that action also turned tradition upside down. And today on Cross Connection, we will see how Jesus opposed tradition. Welcome to an interactive and live study of the Word of God and the life of teachings of Jesus as well. I'm Oleg Kostyuk, your host. Cross Connection is about us studying together. If you're watching us live, you can join our discussion now by sending in our comments, or you can join our ongoing conversation on Facebook anytime. Sergio, what are some ways of people to watch Cross Connection?
Well, we would like people to watch live, if you can. And you can watch us live on Hope Channel, or actually directly from our website. Mm-hmm. Also on our website, while you're there, you can watch every other program we've done ever on demand. You could download a podcast from iTunes, or you could watch the show straight from the Cross Connection app. And I think that's my favorite way. Everything's right there, blog posts. You can even watch live.
Exactly. So I guess what you're saying is that there is no excuse not to watch Cross Connection.
Except for the reasons we give them, I guess.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, moving on. So what is the big question of today's show?
Well, as you know, Oleg, in Matthew 21, we see a really dramatic example of Jesus quite literally overturning a religious tradition of his time. From our perspective, it's easy to see turning the temple into a marketplace as wrong. But what about today? Are there still traditions that we or others practice in the name of religion that maybe go against God? That leads us to today's question. Why was Jesus against tradition, and are there traditions today that he would overturn?
Thanks, Sergio. And I'm looking forward to your comments and your reaction to our main question today. Today, I would like to encourage you to take a journey in time with me. About 3,000 years ago, King David decided to give his country a new lease on life. He decided to capture a city that none of his people had lived in before. He wanted that city to become his capital, so that no one would feel either proud that their city was chosen or excluded because it was someone else's. The problem was that the city was naturally well protected and very easy to defend against attack. The Jebusites, the inhabitants of Jerusalem, saw King David coming with his army and knew they would have no trouble warding him off. They were so sure that they sent him a message. All the regular guards have gone off duty. We've put the blind ones on watch and told the lame ones to take the message. They'll do the job just fine. So how did David conquer the city? David knew that no matter how strongly a city was built on a hill, it needed one thing. It was water. And he had discovered where the spring of water rose. It was a tunnel through which water was transported into the city. That was the way. So Joab, David's general, coordinated the sneak attack on the Jebusite city, and that water tunnel was a crucial element of the successful conquest. This fascinating story is recorded in 2 Samuel chapter 5. I bring this story up because there is also a mysterious phrase there that needs an explanation. This phrase can be found in 2 Samuel 5:8. It says, "The blind and the lame shall not come into the house." Now, let's fast forward 1,000 years. After Jesus triumphantly entered Jerusalem, he cleansed the temple and turned the tables of the money changers upside down. But the most important thing that he did was this. He invited the blind and the lame to come to him in the temple, and he healed them. They were finally allowed in the house. Why is that detail so significant? To find out, we will discuss this later in our program. But first, we are joined today by Jitesh, Marla, and Sergio. Hey. So tell me, did you like the introduction?
Yes.
It was okay. It's not your best work, but okay.
But we will actually discover that the story that happened with David 3,000 years ago had affected the story that happened 2,000 years ago. And there was a period of time for how many years? If you could help me, Matt, do your math. 1,000 years, exactly. So that 1,000 years, and we will see how it influenced what Jesus did. But we will come to it only, unfortunately, a little bit later in the program.
I gotta wait.
Don't go anywhere, because you don't want to miss it. Okay, and before we start studying the Word of God, let us pray. And Sergio, if you could pray for us.
Sure. Father, as we prepare to study your word, we just pray that your spirit fill us, that we remove any impediments that might get in the way of the gifts that you gave us, helping us to better understand your word. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Okay, so help me. What chapter are we studying today?
Matthew 21.
Matthew 21. Well done. So the first question is answered. Okay, so today it's very interesting because before we actually went in the studio, Jitesh was telling us how this story is pretty much the same as we studied before, or maybe different. Tell us what did you tell us before we went in the studio?
I was researching before the show to get some depth to the reading that we had today. So I was researching, looking, going online, looking at stuff, and. Yeah, it just seemed that God, Jesus had said specific things that had come to pass, and is that okay? Is that like, is it just that it came to pass and there's nothing to debate or nothing deep about it?
Okay, so there is two crucial lines. There is nothing to debate, there is nothing deep in it. Okay, I would like to challenge you today because I promise that we will find something amazing in these stories that we, it seems like just simple stories, what Jesus did. I would like to suggest that these three actions that we will be talking about today, three actions of Jesus, not only are they radical, but they are crucial for us to understand. Mm-hmm. And we will see why. Okay, let's go to Matthew chapter 21. We are in Matthew chapter 21, and let's read verses 1 through verse 6. And then if Sergio can read 1 through 6, and then if Marla can continue reading 7 through 11.
All right. Now when they drew near Jerusalem and came to Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them to me. And if anyone says anything to you, you shall say, 'The Lord has need of them,' and immediately he will send them." All this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, lowly, and sitting on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey." So the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them.
They brought the donkey and the colt, and placed their cloaks on them, and Jesus sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of them and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet of Nazareth in Galilee."
Okay, so here is the story. It seems, first of all, we need to remember something, that this story, in the context, Jesus was not in Jerusalem, if you read the Gospel according to Matthew. Have you read any other passage when Jesus was actually in Jerusalem in the Gospel according to Matthew before?
This is it, I think, right?
Yeah.
First time?
This is the first time. Because in the Gospel according to Matthew, this is the first time when Jesus actually enters Jerusalem. If you read the Gospel according to John, we see that Jesus has been to Jerusalem at least three times that we know of. Mm. And most likely he was, because there was one festival that was extremely important to attend. You can help me. What festival? Passover. Passover, exactly. So during that Passover, people from all over Judea and Galilee and all over the Mediterranean world, they would come to Jerusalem.
Yeah.
So this is what is happening now.
Yeah. So, and like you're saying, it seems hugely important because like Jitesh said, when I was reading this, something that strikes out is that it's all plot, you know? There's not as like we've been reading teachings and teachings teachings, and now it's just plot. Things are happening.
It doesn't seem abstract.
Yeah, it's not these abstract teachings. It's a plot, and it seems very. It's got to be very important if we're just getting all plot right now.
Yes. Okay, because sometimes the actions of Jesus can talk better than even words. So we'll see how. So imagine, so there is a Passover, the city is flooded with people. Because according to one of the historians, the regular, like, the amount of inhabitants in Jerusalem would be 30,000. Yeah. But during the Passover, they would have 180,000 people coming.
Wow.
Imagine. Yeah. So how many times more is it, like, It's a lot. Five times more. Five times more. Yeah, I just did my math. No, it's not. It's even more.
More than that.
Six times more. It's not even five. It's six times. Yeah.
Yeah.
So think about it. It's just 180,000. Imagine this crowd going to Jerusalem. What was Jesus's? What was Jesus? What did Jesus want to do? What did Jesus want to achieve by this action?
Well, I imagine you're going to tell us.
Okay, but it's not only me who needs to talk today. Because since we don't talk about teachings, okay, Oleg, just go ahead.
Yeah, let us learn from you. No, I mean, one thing that this doesn't probably relate directly to what you're saying. One thing that stuck out to me, though, is like you're saying, there's a lot of people here, but all the people that are like praising him, it's just kind of like his posse, like his entourage, you know? Because people in Jerusalem are like, who is this guy? What are you guys doing? You know?
This is a very important point.
And I'd always just thought they're all welcoming him, you know? And then you read it closely and you see it's really just the people that were following him, like his group.
So people were asking, who is this?
Yeah, who is this guy? What's all this commotion?
Throwing things onto the ground and, you know.
Well, those people that were, they're like his entourage, exactly. The people that had been following him, his disciples.
That came with Jesus.
Yeah. Okay, excellent. So you see, this is what happens when you study the Bible, literally study the Bible. So you read it carefully and you pay attention to those details. So we see that Jesus was followed by the crowd. And when he sat on a donkey, again, how many donkeys did he sit on? If you just read in verse 2.
There were two mentioned, but did he sit on both of them?
Probably not.
He sat on one at a time, I think.
Yeah. He sat on a colt, which is a small donkey. That hasn't been ridden, it says, yes?
Mm-hmm.
And the colt with her. Lose them. So that colt was, so he would sit on a colt, and that mama donkey, mm-hmm. it would go in front of that donkey mm-hmm. to lead, because that little donkey, he didn't even know how to walk.
He's never done this before.
Who's
this guy up here?
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. But imagine how great of a task it was to be a donkey of a Messiah, a donkey of God,
so
ultimately.
So there must be some significance as to why Jesus didn't sit on the actual mother of the...
Exactly. Excellent. I like how it works. Okay, let's go to Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9. Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9. And Sergio, if you have it.
Sure. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and having salvation, lowly and riding on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. That's what we just read.
Exactly. So this is exactly what we read about Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
But this was the prophecy about the Messiah, and Jesus is fulfilling that prophecy. Let us just think about it for a second. In every teaching and in every chapter that we read before, was Jesus actually crying to everybody that he was the Messiah?
No, he seems to be keeping it on the down low and like, don't tell anybody, mm-hmm. not be flashy or obvious or anything like that.
And what is he doing now?
Well, he's deliberately fulfilling a prophecy about the Messiah in an open way, in a very public place.
Okay.
And that's the question I had. Why is it different this time? Why is it different from every other time before? Why did Jesus choose this time to proclaim who he is?
Yeah, I mean, there's clearly, this mm-hmm. is deliberate, you know? There's, he's going out of his way, like Marla said, to say, no, don't tell anyone mm-hmm. the Messiah, you know? Don't tell mm-hmm. anyone that I did this for you. After he heals someone, and then now he's got this huge processional that he's making his way into the biggest holy city.
Exactly.
So what's going on? What's the difference?
And it's crowded with 180,000
Just so happens
people.
To be at its peak capacity.
Yeah, peak capacity as well. You know, in order to answer that question, we will need to go deeper in the story, and we will have to continue studying. But unfortunately, you'll have to take a break. But after that short break, I hope you said exactly the same as Sergio did. Oh, this break. But don't go anywhere. As we take a break, think about today's question and share your thoughts with us. Why was Jesus against tradition, and are there traditions he would ever turn today? See you soon, right after the break. Welcome back to Cross Connection. We just walked with Jesus into Jerusalem with this great processional, yeah? And Jesus was praised. And what people were shouting all the time around him?
Hosanna.
Hosanna. What does it mean, Hosanna?
Okay.
It's very cool because it means save us now.
Save us now.
And we learned that those people who were following Jesus and who were spreading their cloaks or outer garments, they were Galileans. And that is why when people who lived in Jerusalem, they rose a question, so who is this guy? Who is this gentleman? They said, oh, this is Jesus, the prophet of Nazareth, from Nazareth of Galilee. So he is the prophet, he is the one, and what is their expectation? Save us now.
They know who he is because they're asking him to save them.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay, now let us just talk about their idea of savior.
They're captive by Roman, Empire.
Exactly.
So they're looking for somebody who's going to free them physically from the bonds that they experience on this world.
Yeah.
Exactly. That is exactly what was happening.
And we've gone over it before. You know, it's a theme we've gone over before. How the expectations of the time. It's easy from our perspective to understand salvation as we know it now, but at the time they just thought, save us, my life sucks, please.
Exactly. You know? Exactly. I don't have enough bread. Yeah. I'm always oppressed.
Yeah.
I cannot. You know, Galileans. Galileans in Jerusalem, they were always foreigners. What are those Galileans? They are just peasants.
Yeah.
We are here. We live in Jerusalem. Like, what are those? And who is this prophet?
Yeah.
Prophet of peasants.
Well, it would have gotten everybody's attention to walk into the middle of an empire at its peak time of the year, and basically say things that sound like you're going to come in and overthrow it.
Absolutely.
But
yes.
Reading and, you know, diving into it more when I was researching, the city was in a stir at that time. Like, if things were uncertain. So it's like almost Jesus chose a pristine time to come in where people were somewhat open to the fact of, hey, who is this? Otherwise, as opposed to saying, this is not our king, we don't want to have anything to do with him. Something drew them to Jesus, to even ask the question.
Absolutely. And there is something crucial. And let me ask you, and just maybe you can, I hope you will be able to answer it. Of course you will. What does this story teach us about Jesus? How did he enter? Because there is one crucial word in verse 5.
Is it humble?
Exactly.
Lowly.
How did he enter into Jerusalem?
If you think about it, you're not even on a real donkey, you're on a baby donkey.
Right.
He's
not even on the best donkey.
They take clothes and put it, so there's no saddle. There's nothing in front of them. People just start putting clothes and leaves. Mm-hmm.
He doesn't even have a proper saddle. He's sitting on their cloaks
like
that they threw over it.
To this day, you don't do things like that.
So
this is like very, very humble. As humble as it gets.
It's pretty interesting mix of like bombastic and humble.
Absolutely.
He makes a big scene, but he's humble about it.
Absolutely.
It's interesting.
And this is the Messiah. This is God.
Yes.
He's humble, lowly, walking in. And this is exactly what he was teaching about in Matthew chapter 18, 19, and 20 of Matthew.
Yeah.
We read about what is greatness.
Yeah.
When you become a servant, that is true greatness. Yeah. And this is the true greatness of the king entering the city. Not, I need your praises. No,
right.
I want to praise you.
And that ties into what Marla was saying about how their expectations were that he's going to be a conqueror, mm-hmm. and he's going to be strong, and he's going to overtake this empire now. But really, just the very nature of God becoming a filthy human being is the utmost type of humility that you can imagine. And he's coming for something entirely different, not to glorify himself and raise himself on this earth, but to save us as a gift like a servant.
Exactly. So now we are entering through this gate into Jerusalem, and now let's see what Jesus is doing. And we need to read these verses. It's verses 12 through 17. And Jitesh, if you could read them for us.
Then Jesus went into the temple of God and drove out all those who bought and sold in the temple, and overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. And he said to them, "It is written, 'My house shall be called a house of prayer,' but you have made it a den of thieves." Then the blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children crying out in the temple and saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David," they were indignant, and said to him, "Do you hear what these are saying?" And Jesus said to them, "Yes. Have you ever read? Out of the mouth of babes and nursing infants, you have perfected praise." Then he left them and went out of the city to Bethany, and he lodged there.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so now Jesus is up to something very serious.
Very serious. Yeah.
So what did he do now? Tell me.
He lost his temper.
Oh, really?
I mean, he's throwing over benches and calling it people a house, like, this is a den of robbers. That's pretty brazen accusations. Mm-hmm. And you don't just say those, like, quietly.
Yeah. So imagine this procession. This enormous procession is entering Jerusalem. Now they enter Jerusalem. It's not enough to enter Jerusalem. Let's go to the most holy place in Jerusalem.
And wreck it.
Yeah. I would like us to take a very close look at this most holy place, which is the temple. Let's look together at the temple. Okay. How did the temple look? And I would like to see all of us to see it. So as you see, this is the temple of Herod. This is how it looked at the time of Jesus. Do you see this enormous structure?
Yes.
If you think about it, it's in
circumference.
Like, so circumference is 1 mile.
Wow.
So it was enormous structure. So that was the court, as you see. And then in the middle, right in the middle, that was the exact temple. So in the middle, you see a temple, the temple itself. But at the left side, as you see, there is a portico, mm-hmm. this long portico. And most likely, everything like selling and buying was happening right there. But if you turn a little bit to the right, you will see that was actually it was called the court of Gentiles. The court of Gentiles. So this was the court of Gentiles. So we can clearly see the picture. Mm-hmm. So this is where the selling and buying was happening. Then there was a court of Gentiles. And then in the middle, there was the temple itself. Only Jews were allowed to get into the temple itself. There was also the court for women. And then there was only priests who were allowed in the holy and the most holy place. So this is where it was happening. Mm. Now imagine Jesus finally going there. And what did he do?
He's overturning tables and spilling things and throwing things and yelling at people.
Have you ever read anything like of this nature of Jesus before when he was just as angry as here?
Yeah, I mean, it's nothing like this. Jesus has had this like fascinating mix of humility mm-hmm. and this, you know, I'm meek and lowly in heart. Yet on the Sermon on the Mount, he spoke with authority, so much so that it shocked people, mm-hmm, you know, mm-hmm. and here he's like throwing things, he's barely coming to Jerusalem and he's turning things over. You know, there's like this strength in his humility all at this in one package. It's kind of hard to wrap my mind around sometimes.
Okay, but why was it happening at all? If you think about it, why would people even sell and buy things in the temple? This is
a good question, because, I mean, that's obviously corruption then, right? I mean, I don't know any other way of thinking about it, is that all this holiness and all this stuff that's supposed to be going on in, that's like thinking of a church nowadays. Mm-hmm. Think of the church we go to, and right outside the sanctuary, like in the corridor lobby, people are selling things. Do you want an iPod? Do you want, you know, all these kinds of things? Like, you know, how could you even imagine something like that happening?
The temple is supposed to be your connection to God. It's a sacred spiritual place. It's where you connect with God, and you're just using it to turn a buck, you know, and all of the stuff your pockets now on this earth. It's completely antithetical.
Well, it wasn't even just turning a buck. It's turning a dishonest buck. I mean, because they invented the temple currency.
Absolutely.
Like, they had to have special animals to sacrifice. You couldn't just bring what you had brought of your heart to present before God. You had to come through them, and they could charge you whatever they wanted.
That is a very important point. On the one hand, it was perfectly fine, because to be honest, if you think about it, it was something that was very useful and helpful. Think about people who were coming from Greece, for instance, to Passover, during the Passover, to take a live animal from Greece. It would take, the journey would take about 1 week. Mm-hmm. So if you take a live animal, it can die even through this road, on the journey over. Yeah, but what was happening actually, as Marla just said, that they had their own currency first, and also they just became corrupted, and this is exactly what Jesus is strongly against, because he said something, my house shall be called a house of prayer. And this line is extremely important. We will actually get to our main question after the break, and we will also learn something very unique about this passage that can open our eyes. So I promise you, don't go anywhere, Jitesh. Don't forget to share your thoughts about today's question: why was Jesus against tradition, and are there traditions he would overturn today? Let us know what you think, and your comment will be read here in the studio. Welcome back. The study of the Word of God sets our hearts on fire. And if you feel the same, don't keep it to yourself, because we need your comments and we need your participation in our discussion, don't we?
Yes, we do.
Yeah, yes. because that's why it's live. It's live. Not only live because it's live on television, because it's lively.
Exactly.
Okay. So we've reached a very interesting point when Jesus actually enters the temple. And I just, before the break, I read one line which is very important. What Jesus is actually saying, why was he so angry with what was happening? This line says, my house shall be called the house of prayer. Mm-hmm. And then in every other gospel, that is Mark, Luke, and John, there is a continuation of that line. And that continuation is also taken from Isaiah chapter 56, verse 7. Isaiah chapter 56, verse 7. Let's get there for 1 second.
Okay.
Isaiah chapter 56, verse 7.
Even them I will bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house shall be called a house of prayer for all nations.
Okay, I would like you to read the last part of that verse one more time.
For all nations.
So my house is the house of prayer for whom?
All nations.
All nations. What does it mean, all nations, in the time of Jesus?
Everyone.
Only the Jews?
No.
All nations, which means Gentiles. In fact, that word in Greek, nations, means Gentile. So for all Gentiles. Now, let's get back to the temple. Now I would like to see us the structure again.
Okay.
Us to see the structure. So we see this structure, this enormous structure. And in this structure, there was one court, which was the court of Gentiles. There was a fence. A large fence around the inner, and we can see it. We can see the temple. So the temple itself was surrounded by a fence. We see a big wall, but there was also a smaller fence. And on that fence, there was stones, and we can see that we will be able to see those stones now as well. Those stones were saying that Gentiles are not allowed to enter there under the penalty of death.
Wow.
So Gentiles were not allowed to go behind that fence.
Which goes directly against
what
we just read.
Exactly. Mm. So Jesus is saying, you know what? I wanted you to be the light of the world. Mm. But what have you become? A den of robbers.
Yeah.
Because you're just trying to, as Sergio was saying, just fill your pockets. And you forget completely about what you were created for.
Yeah.
And that against Jesus is breaking the tradition, it seems.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's what our question's about. And he sees something that's supposed to be holy. And mm-hmm. for whatever reasons, through human machinations, it has grown into something else entirely. Something that really is like an abomination towards mm-hmm. what is taught earlier and what it was intended for.
Well, it's especially disappointing for people who come from all of, like, they're coming from around the world and they're coming here to worship God, but they're not able to do that because the people that are supposed to be representing mm-hmm. God are interfering, both by their actions and by the way that the temple is set up.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And look, Jesus is going to die soon. He knows it. He's about to die, and what he's about to accomplish is going to save all peoples. And this is something that represents a gospel that is selective and only for the certain people, and that is something that he just will not abide, you know, and he's just going to overthrow it entirely. Like, this cannot stand. This is not what I'm about.
Absolutely, because he's bringing them to the point where they need to decide, because the judgment is coming. You need to make your path straight. And that is why this is exactly what in the entire Gospel according to Matthew, we see this beautiful picture of Jesus being David and Savior, which is David, Messiah, because David was also expected as to be Messiah to be. So he is the son of David. He is called the son of David. He is Messiah, in other words. And as in chapter 1, it was actually our first episode, and I would like to encourage you to go to our first episode. It's very easy, it's very accessible. You can do it via our app,
or go to the website.
Website or podcast.
Yep.
You can go and watch our first episode. In that first episode, we saw how Jesus was, in the genealogy of Jesus, when we saw four women, all of them were Gentiles, and they were related or were prostitutes or had some sort of very shady reputation.
Right.
And they were accepted. Yeah. By Jesus. And this is what Jesus is saying now,
right
before his death. I need to accomplish this. I want you to know that I have come to destroy something that you've thought about.
Yeah.
And I want to build something new.
And, you know, I want to read a comment that ties in exactly what we're saying now, because we're talking about, Cheryl is saying something that goes exactly what we're talking about now, how the gospel, Jesus died for everyone, absolutely everyone. And this goes against that. And so she says, I believe that Jesus was against tradition because it wiped out the evidence of his love.
Mm.
And we have here a tradition that is going against, spitting in the face of his love and what the gospel is really about. And so he wasn't going to hold back in his contempt of it.
Uh-huh. Jitesh, what do you think?
It doesn't explain the angry part. So, I mean, maybe I'm not going too far off, but that's I was looking for, is like some kind of an explanation for Jesus being angry. Because how does that apply to us now? You know, because if Jesus didn't control his anger at that time and could lose it for something like this, does that give us opportunity to be able to do such a thing when the time is needed?
Well, I wouldn't say he lost it. You can be angry and not lose it. You know, I don't know if he's foaming at the mouth and and regretting afterwards, oh man, I wish I hadn't done that. I really flew off the handle, you know.
I didn't assume that he was that angry, but just the fact that he showed that anger in order to overturn, because you can get angry in order to make a point.
Yeah.
Is this the kind of anger that you feel that Jesus was showing?
Yeah, and I think it's like Cheryl's comment said, Jesus is about to die in 6 days or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
He's about to die in just a few days, and he's about to die for everyone. His salvation is for everyone. And here you see a practice in the temple that is exclusive, that is focused not on holy things, not on God, but it's going in a dangerously wrong direction. And he's not going to go, hey guys, maybe you shouldn't do that. He's going to very forcefully go, this needs to stop, because this is not the truth. This is not the way.
But if you look carefully in verse 14, and then look what Jesus did after this anger, it seems like. What did he do, Marla?
verse 14.
He's healing the blind and the lame. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And they come to him. It's not like they're scared of him, you know. No. They come right to him, you know.
Well, I think it's interesting because it seems like the uneducated, the blind, the lame, the children, they instantly recognize that what he's doing is a good thing. Mm-hmm. But they're the only ones.
Yeah.
For the officials, like, look at the reaction of the officials. Do you hear what they're saying? Yeah. They're not supposed to say that you are the son of David.
And I think they get a sense, too, that this guy is on my side. Like, this guy cares about me. You know, Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. I think they get a sense, you know, I think this guy, he's fighting on my behalf. He's upset because I'm being marginalized, you know, and so they're just drawn to him.
So basically, Jesus wasn't as upset as we were thinking. Because when we were discussing it before, it seemed throwing things and, you know, like extremely angry. He's not.
I just think there's a big difference between being upset and being out of control. Okay. You know.
And he was upset because his temple of his father, it wasn't used in the right way. He was upset.
Yeah.
But maybe he was angry because God is not pleased with what we sometimes are doing. Mm-hmm. And so let's just get to our question, main question of tonight, of today, when we talked about the tradition. Sometimes it seems like tradition, and Jesus was against tradition in this way, wasn't he?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Was he against the temple?
No,
he was not. But was he against what was happening in the temple?
Yes,
he was.
And this is a case where, for me, it's super easy to point fingers, you know, and see all these people. See, they're being just like those people were back then. But to me, these people thought of themselves as godly people. You know, they thought that they were religious, good, godly people, and they were going drastically against the will of God. And it's something to contemplate when you can think you're being godly, but if your heart's in the wrong place and your mind's in the wrong place, you could be going drastically against the will of God, and you could be adopting a tradition that is poison to your relationship with God.
So how do you guard yourself from doing that? I mean, if it's so easy that they can do it, then I'm sure I can do it. What can I do so that I don't fall into that trap?
That is a very important question.
Yeah, that's the
question. What can we do?
Yeah.
Let's just repeat this question. If you could repeat this question for us.
If it's so easy to fall into this trap of what can I do to not
fall into this trap, exactly.
Yeah.
And we will talk about it right after the break. So if you have your computer nearby, now is the perfect time to go online and answer our question and also give us your comments. Write to us, why was Jesus against tradition, and are there traditions he would overturn today? And don't forget to like us on Facebook if you haven't yet. We'll be back in studio to continue our discussion after a break. Welcome back. If you want to join our discussion, and I know that you want, the contact information is on your screen. So we've gone through two main actions that Jesus performs when he gets in Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. First, we learned that there was this magnificent procession. And second, we learned that he was upset about what was happening in the temple. He was literally upset. And he was even angry with what people have done with his temple. But his anger was with love, because then he invited those people who needed him the most, and he started healing them.
Yeah.
And in my introduction, I mentioned that when David was actually besieging the city of Jerusalem, he actually asked all of them, all blind and crippled, to keep outside, to stay outside of the city. Mm-hmm. But Jesus does something very different. He accepts them.
Yeah.
So let's go forward, because that forward will answer all of our questions, I believe, and I hope.
Right.
The fig tree. And Sergio, if you could read for us verses 18 and 19.
All right. Now in the morning, as he returned to the city, he was hungry. And seeing a fig tree by the road, he came to it and found nothing on it but leaves, and said to it, let no fruit grow on you ever again. Immediately the fig tree withered away.
And then if we can continue 20 and 21 as well.
And when the disciples saw it, they marveled, saying, how did the fig tree wither away so soon? So Jesus answered and said to them, assuredly I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only do what was done to the fig tree, but also if you say to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, it will be done. And whatever you ask in prayer, believing, you will receive.
Okay.
Okay, so whenever Jesus does a miracle, there's always a purpose behind it, but this just seems harsh and judgmental.
Look at Jesus now. Like, he's entering Jerusalem, he takes possession of the city, then he does something.
Seemingly, we have like an angry Jesus now. He's overturning things, he's cursing fig trees because he's hungry, you know.
No, it doesn't make any sense, does it?
You know, we were talking earlier and you said something that I had never even thought of or had known before when you mentioned how the fact that it had leaves on it, mm-hmm. and how that was special.
Yes, so thanks for putting it out, otherwise, lest I forget. Yeah. So what was happening? What time frame are we talking about? Time of the year we are talking about? During the what festival?
Passover.
Passover. Passover is always March, April. Sometimes between March and April. In March and April, fig trees usually don't have any leaves on them at all. Hmm. So no leaves. Hmm. But this tree actually has leaves. Isn't it strange?
Yeah. Yeah.
So now Jesus comes to this fig tree because he was hungry, because when he was coming back from, he was returning to the city, yes? Mm-hmm. As we just read in verse 18. So then he says, let no fruit grow on you ever again. And immediately the fig tree withered.
So it's like he sees leaves on it and, oh, this tree has leaves. Surely but it must have fruit because it has leaves.
Absolutely.
Because they shouldn't have leaves at this point. So this one must have fruit that, you know, I can eat.
So what happened? This tree offered promise without fulfillment.
Wow.
This tree offered promise without fulfillment.
So it was like a fake tree.
It had the appearance of a tree that would have fruit.
Yeah.
But then you examine it and there's no fruit.
So tell me about the entire story, what the entire story is about. Jesus enters Jerusalem that offers promise mm-hmm. without fulfillment. Mm. Jesus enters the temple that offers promise, because this is the place where God abides, mm-hmm. without fulfillment. Wow. And here's another judgment comes.
Wow.
And then they continue. We need to read that last passage. I mean, we need to remember what is in that in the fig tree when he talks about the mountain.
Yeah, yeah.
This is something that we need to remember.
Yeah, I mean, you read that and you think it's a measure of like how powerful your faith can be if you mm-hmm. have a lot of faith.
But we need to bring it into the context.
Right.
Jesus was coming back from, because it was 180,000 people, so there was not enough place in Jerusalem itself. So they would stay outside of the Jerusalem, mm-hmm. outside of Jerusalem, coming back to Jerusalem. They saw the fig tree. What is in front of them then, when they're coming back to Jerusalem? The temple on Jerusalem.
And the temple. Yeah.
And the temple. And the temple was on the mountain. And when Jesus says, if you believe, you will say to this mountain, what did he say? Be removed and be cast into the sea, and it will be done. And this is exactly what happened with the temple.
Man, I mean, talk about context,
the temple
adding meaning.
On the mountain, it was thrown into the sea because the temple ceased to exist in year 70 when Romans came. So this is, the judgment was fulfilled. Mm. Now, tell me, what does it mean in our life today? Isn't this the answer to your question? When we promise this fake promises, mm-hmm. when we offer those fake promises and don't have any fulfillment,
yeah.
we are not even Christians then.
Yeah, and in verse 22 it says, whatever you ask in prayer, believing, you will receive. To me that implies you'll receive my spirit, you'll receive me, you will be my temple now. Not this building, not this place that where all this terrible things can happen. I want you to be my temple. Just call on me directly and you'll receive.
Okay, let's get to our main question and just flood it with our comments from viewers and your comments as well.
So, let me read a comment here from Andrew that kind of sums it up. It says, Jesus showed that you can be angry for righteous reasons. He said, be ye angry and sin not, let not the sun go down upon your wrath, Ephesians 4:26. Mm-hmm. You know, we show kind of what he had in mind. We also have another text that says, traditions can stand in the way of truth, even if the followers mean well.
Mm.
So
this is what happened. So tell me what did you learn from this study and learn about tradition? Because that was the tradition that Jesus was against. Okay, and we have a few other comments I can see. Mm-hmm. Sergio is ready to read them. So what did you learn about the tradition? What did you learn today?
Well, I don't think it doesn't seem like it's the tradition itself that's the issue. Mm-hmm. It's whenever it interferes with how God is presented to people.
Yes.
When it obstructs his love, I think you mentioned.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you get the sense that almost to view it in terms of tradition and not tradition, I mean, that's the way you look at it at first because it's so jarring. Like, we've believed this for so long, but you're just throwing it out. But you see that it's not even, you can't look at it through the lens of tradition and not tradition. It's about direct relationship with God, direct interaction with God and nothing else. It's just about God and his love. And anything, don't even pay attention to things that get in the way of that.
This is great to be honest. This is cool. Mm-hmm. Because if you think about it, this is what the true discussion is about. Yeah. When we talk about it and when we see the truth coming on the surface.
Yeah.
Okay, do we have any other comments, Sergio?
Yeah, Alvaro actually drops a T.S. Eliot quote on us. It says, "Tradition without intelligence is not worth having." And then quoting Jesus, or kind of paraphrasing, summing up, Jesus says, religious tradition without a real relationship with God is worthless.
Amen.
And okay. That's what it's about.
Okay. Other comments?
Yeah, sure. Melissa says, because he knew that traditions are things that man on earth created, and that is why he might have been against it. He wanted us to do things in God's laws and in God's ways. Excellent. You know, and we had another show on this, earlier when it was Matthew, was it 10 or 11, I'm forgetting now, earlier where Jesus directly mm-hmm. was dealing with this issue of tradition and how it can get in the way of your experience with God.
Okay, we have 2 minutes left, so now it's time for you to tell us what you learned today. Okay, Jitesh.
Oh, well, I have to say that when you challenged me that I was wrong, and I actually feel good that I was wrong because, man, there's so much crucial power-packed things in this, especially with the fig tree. I had, when I read it, I almost glanced over it. It was just like something I had read. And mm-hmm. so basically these steps are what I should be following in my life. Jesus coming in humbly, going to church and, you know, making a difference and having a real connection with God. And then especially with the fig tree, don't be fake. You know, this is not about pretending to be Jesus's follower. It's about not being a fan, but being a follower of Jesus.
Excellent, excellent. Thanks, Jitesh. Marla, what did you learn today?
Well, it really is about that authentic relationship. And I know, like myself, I have a tendency to go on autopilot with things, and after I've done it so many times, I don't even think about it. But this is really about keeping it fresh, even though you've been a Christian all your mm-hmm. life, still continue to put that conscientious effort into it. Otherwise, you'll naturally become like the temple and the fig tree. And
excellent. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Sergio.
Yeah, I'll just read some more viewer comments. Orchidea says something on Facebook that is about how traditions can sometimes slowly change mm-hmm. and become corrupted. So I think that Jesus was against some of the traditions of the people. The traditions set by people are sometimes contrary to the Word of God. Some traditions in the Bible were established, but over time, they were completely changed by people. The people did not break their tradition, but broke the traditions that had been set based on the Word of God. For example, God said in the Ten Commandments, there should be no other gods before him, and that we should not make graven images. These traditions were broken countless of times by the Israelite nation in biblical times and are still being broken today. As the discussion says, the Jewish leaders set a tradition completely 360 degrees from what God had planned for the use of the temple. It should have been a place for all nations, but the mm-hmm. leaders divided it, even having the penalty of breaking such a tradition to be death.
Okay. Wow. Thank you so much for this great discussion. I learned a lot today.
Oh, yes.
Okay. Thank you, Sergio. Thank you, Marla. Thank you, Jitesh. Thanks to everyone who was able to join us today. And I will be back after a very short break with today's very important conclusion. So don't go anywhere. Jesus' arrival in Jerusalem was very dramatic. Three actions of Jesus provoked people to think about him as the Messiah. The first action was the royal procession to the city walls. The second action was the attack on the traders in the temple courtyard. And the third action was the judgment of the fig tree. By the act of triumphal procession, Jesus stated that he was the Messiah. By the act of turning the tables of the money changers, Jesus also turned the temple tradition upside down. And on the example of a withered fig tree, he demonstrated that the judgment will come. I can only imagine how difficult it was to be witness to all these actions. C.S. Lewis, in his book Mere Christianity, wrote a profound line that recently caught my attention. He wrote, "Imagine yourself as a living house. God comes in to rebuild that house. At first, perhaps you can understand what he is doing. He is getting the drains right and stopping the leaks in the roof, and so on. You knew that those jobs needed doing, and so you are not surprised. But presently, he starts knocking the house about in a way that hurts abominably and does not seem to make any sense. What on earth is he up to? The explanation is that he is building quite a different house from the one you thought of. Throwing out a new wing here, putting on an extra floor there, running up towers, making courtyards. You thought you were being made into a decent little cottage, but he is building a palace. He intends to come and live in that palace himself." Today, I would like to challenge you to let Jesus rebuild you, even if it breaks your traditions. Jesus wants to enter triumphantly into your life today. Sometimes we might allow him to do that, but we don't want to let him turn the tables of our money changers. If you haven't let Jesus in yet, today I would like to challenge you to let him in. If you let him in and let him overturn the tables, trust me, he will rebuild your life and he will dwell in you. Until next week, stay connected with Jesus Christ in your everyday life and on Cross Connection.